Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for the Holocaust Center for Humanities Lunch and Learn program. I'm Alana Cohn Kennedy, the Chief Operating Officer at the Holocaust Center. A live transcript for this program is available on Zoom for anyone who would like to use it. Click Live Transcript at the bottom of the screen, and then click Show Subtitles. The Holocaust Center for Humanity is located in downtown Seattle, just a few blocks from the famous Pike Place Market. The Holocaust Center sits on the traditional land of the Coast Salish peoples. We honor with gratitude the land itself and those who came before us, stewarded the land, and remain leaders and activists within our communities. Thank you to all of you for joining the program today. Whether you are watching this live or maybe at a later date, we are so glad you are here to learn with us and to hear these incredible stories. It's not everyone who wants to spend an extra hour learning and thinking about tough topics, and this is really a special community. This Thursday is our annual Sip and Learn program organized by our young adult leadership group called Ambassadors for Change. The program is hybrid. You can join in person at the Holocaust Center or online. The evening will be filled with storytelling, creativity, and exploring art as an act of resistance, resilience, and healing. You can find out more and buy tickets on our website. This program is a fundraiser for the Holocaust Center, and all proceeds go to help support the Holocaust Center and a couple of our partner organizations, which you can read more about on our website. Today's program is the first in our series, A Summer of Stories. Last week, the Holocaust Center hosted a thank you event for our speakers bureau. It was a warm, sunny day, and Lori Wershel Cohen generously offered her home as a place for everyone to gather. Our speakers bureau ranges from Holocaust survivors in their 90s to children and grandchildren of survivors. All of them are there because they have a story to tell, a story that translates the overwhelming history of the Holocaust into a real person. These are stories that will challenge you, complicate your thinking, and inspire you. And ultimately, we remember that these individuals who survived, died, suffered, persevered, we remember their memories and we keep their memories alive. Judaism has a long tradition of reciting the names of the dead. In Jewish tradition, every person dies three deaths. The first death is the death of the body. The second is when the soul leaves the body, and the third death occurs after the very last time that anyone still living says the person's name aloud. As I sat among the survivors, the storytellers, the descendants, I felt immense gratitude for their willingness to trust us with such personal details of their lives and to put their faith in the rest of us that we will listen and remember. And so with our Summer of Stories series, we bring you some of these remarkable stories so that we can all say and remember these names. Because as long as we keep saying their names, their memories live on and drive us to action. We have an incredible author and scholar joining us today to talk about her award-winning book, 999, The Extraordinary Young Women of the First Official Jewish Transport to Auschwitz. Forward reviews praise the book for its respect, sympathy, and important contribution to Holocaust literature, stating, Heather Dune Macadam's 999 reinstates the girls to their rightful place in history. In addition to 999, Heather Dune Macadam is the acclaimed author of Rena's Promise, A Story of Sisters in Auschwitz. Heather Dune is a board member of the Cities of Peace, Auschwitz, and the director and president of the Rena's Promise Foundation. Her work to fight Holocaust denial has been recognized by Yad Vashem in the UK and Israel, the USC Shoah Foundation, the National Museum of Jewish History in Bratislava, Slovakia, and others. Heather is the producer and director of the documentary film by the same name as her book, 999. And her work has been featured in National Geographic, on PBS, and other major media outlets. We will take questions at the end of the program. Please enter your questions anytime through the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. And I'd like to now invite Heather to please come join us. And thank you so much, Heather, for being with us today from New York.
Thank you so much, Alana. I'm so glad to be here. What a wonderful opportunity to speak to your audience and to people on the West Coast. I hope it's cooler there than it is here. And I'm sorry if you're a little bit of background noise, I have a fan going. We're not as hot as it is in Europe right now, so I'm grateful for that. So I've got a presentation that I'm gonna do, and I'm gonna share a screen. You'll see some excerpts from our film. You'll see some archival photographs, and I will tell you a bit about these extraordinary young women that I have met personally, many of them, about seven, and then who I haven't met, but I have researched their stories through the USC Shoah Foundation testimony archive, as well as written records that have been shared with me by families. And I still get, I'm still getting material in, which is really incredible. So I'm just gonna go on here and give us a little screen share. And just gonna make sure this is all correct, because I just, of course, just moved it a tiny bit. Sorry about that. So these are some of the translations, and I should have put, I've just got the Romanian translation, and this week I'm going to be doing work in press in Romania. I'm really excited. It's really something to see, you know, your work as an author translated into other languages, and to reach people all over the world. And I'm on Goodreads. I don't know if anybody here is on Goodreads, but it's really something. I'll get, you know, comments in Lithuanian and Romanian and languages I don't know, thank God for DeepL. So I can find out what they've said and I can converse with people. So I love to be able to communicate with my audience. And we also have a fan page on Facebook where you can drop in questions if you don't get questions answered today. And that you can find us at 999themovie.com or 999thebook.com. That's our website, and we're also on Facebook. So I'm gonna start giving you just a little bit of the film and how our movie starts. And so you can see some of the footage and get an idea. This is going to open with an amazing experience that I had. I was at the Holocaust Museum in Washington, DC, doing some archival research in the film department. And as I was watching this footage, it looked like home movies. I saw Edith, who is the featured narrator of my book, Edith Grossman. And I saw her husband in this footage when he was a little boy. And I recognized him because I had seen a picture of him as a little boy with his cap on. And I texted her son and I said, and I, you know, literally holding up my phone and I'm going, is this your dad? And he goes, that's not just my dad, that's my grandfather who died in the Holocaust. And he had never seen this footage before. So that's how we open our movie. It's, oh, I get chills just thinking about it.
The whole tragedy starts with the girls. My eyes, the girls were the worst. They have been the first victims.
Together.
One morning we wake up and we saw outside on the street, it was glued on the houses, an announcement that all the Jewish girls, non-married girls from 16 up, have to come to the school on this and this street, the 20th of March 1942, for work.
And then there is a little window up on the top. I saw my father standing near the big gate, waving to me.
I think the video was frozen on your end.
We didn't know where we are going. We didn't have any idea. We were about 50 or maybe 60.
No, is it frozen on your end? Anything.
Yes, it is.
Okay, sorry about that. No, it's not frozen. It's playing okay here. Let me see.
It's frozen for all the viewers.
It is. At what point did it freeze?
About a minute ago.
Okay. All right. Sorry about that. Not sure we're having technical difficulties. I'll go ahead and move forward. The first transport came from Eastern Slovakia. And this is Lou Gross. He was 4 years old when his cousin Adela, who was a beautiful redhead, boarded the train. And what Edith just told us is that the government of Slovakia made a deal with the Nazis, and that they were going to send 20,000 workers to Germany for work. And the Slovak government decided to send girls first. Well, I don't think it was the Slovak government that decided that. I think it was Himmler who decided that. We don't have any proof of that, but my book, I actually talk about why I believe that. You know, if you want to destroy a race of people, you attack your young women, right? Your, you know, the nurturers of the race. And the first transport, you had to be unmarried, you had to be a virgin, and you had to be between the ages of 16 and 32. So many, many of the girls on the first transport were teenagers. Adela grew up with Edith Grossman, and her sister will later become Edith's sister-in-law. Adela was this beautiful redhead, and she was actually, my very first book, Rena's Promise, Rena saw Adela go to the gas chamber, and she knew her from Humana. So I have this incredible circle with the Gross family, in that I had never seen a photograph of Adela. I had only heard the story of Adela going to the gas chamber, and the Gross family, by reading my book, Rena's Promise, discovered what happened to Adela and sent me a photograph of her. And that clued me in. There was so much more history to the first transport than I knew. And within 48 hours, I learned that Edith was in her 90s, lived in Toronto, was in Slovakia, and I arranged to meet Edith, who also knew Adela and had grown up with her. And so suddenly what started from one survivor became this loop into all of these other survivors. And the thing that is so moving for me about this story is that Edith went to school with all of these girls on the transport. And so she was able to tell me about them. And here she is in her 90s. She's looking at her class photo and she's telling me the girls' names. There's seven Jewish girls in this class and each one who died. One of the girls, this one up the top, the tall girl, Regina Haber, one of Edith's friends reports in her testimony in the Shoah Foundation about Regina dying. So what happens is that because Edith gives me this structure, I'm able to go into other testimonies and go, oh, that's who she's talking about. That's who Margita's talking about. That's who so-and-so is talking about. And I'm able to connect these dots, which becomes this vast web and a tapestry of information and of young women who are on this first transport. So one of the reasons we start the film with typing is that there's a list And I'm going to show you that to you in just a second, but I want to introduce, this is Edith when she was a young girl. And this is her sister, Leah, and Anna Hertzkovikova. So we are speaking their names so that they can be remembered. Leah does not survive. So this is the very first list, and it is the local list that was given to the gendarmes, the police, and it's alphabetical, as you can see. This is the road, this is Leia's name, and this is Edith's name, Edita, and this is the road they lived on, Halinkova, and these are their birth dates. And it's checked off, and it's checked off because they went to school. They were told to go to a school and sign up. And they got there and they thought, oh, we're gonna go home, it was Shabbat. They thought, oh, we'll go home and have Shabbat dinner. They didn't. They were immediately shipped out, not to Auschwitz, but to Poprad, which is this tiny little town, into a barracks. And there they were, an army barrack. They were held there for 5 days while the Holinka guards and the local police gathered 999 young women from all over Eastern Slovakia to go on the first transport. So the original list of all 999 girls is at Yad Vashem in Israel. And this is a GIF, so hopefully it will work. This is Orna Tuckman with her son, and they are looking at the list right now, and she is finding, that's her mother's name, Marta Friedmanova. And the number is the number that they were typed on the list. It's not their tattoo as they were registered. I'll show this to you again. It's quite an extraordinary document. You can, it's very old. You have to use gloves to touch it.
So Heather, sorry to interrupt. Again, the video is not playing. I think if you click on the view menu at the upper right, and there may be the setting to optimize for video, I think that might be the issue.
Okay, that's so odd. Let's see. What if I do presenter view? Maybe that would work better. Let's see. Let me just stop sharing for a second. Sorry, everybody.
So yeah, when you do the share and then click on that checkbox at the bottom of the screen that says optimize for video, that might help.
I have it optimized for video.
Okay, that's my only suggestion. Otherwise, we'll just keep going.
Let's see. That's odd. Yeah, it's not showing in presenter view either. Well, it worked fine yesterday, didn't it?
Why don't you just go on back ahead?
And always, it's always like that.
Right? It looks good for us, but unfortunately for the people viewing, they don't see it, so.
Yeah, I'm so sorry, everybody. Let's see if I can do, is this? That's still not working, correct? Yeah. Okay. All right. Actually, I've got to pause here because now I've screwed up my own document. There we go. Sorry about that, folks. Yeah, gotta go back to the screen share. But you're able to see it without it moving, correct?
Correct. It moves sometimes, so it's pretty good actually.
Okay, this is a GIF, so so you can see the document down there. I just wanted to address, just in case it does move, Margaret Beck Friedmanova, Orna's mother. It's a very interesting story. Orna discovered that she was adopted after her mother died, and her mother was sterilized in Auschwitz. And I traveled with her to Auschwitz as she was discovering this truth because her mother had just passed away. Now this is the original, this is an incredible document. It's the original railway invoice. Yeah, they invoice these people. And it has the date. It says Poprad, Tatry, where they're going, where they're coming from, where they're going to, Auschwitz. And you can see down here, it says 3,700, it's Reichmark. That's how much they're charging for the girls to take their one-way trip to Auschwitz. Their luggage is 360. And here's the date down here, March 25th, 1942. So one of the women that you didn't get to hear in that little video clip is Elizabeth Bentz. Silverstein Bentz. And that's her married name. Silverstein was her maiden name. And she turned 19 on her birthday on the 25th of March. And she talks about being on the train, being put into the cattle car. So once again, they were held for 5 days, and then they were put into a cattle car and sent to Auschwitz. So they arrive in Auschwitz, and the thing that, you know, people think, oh, the death gate, you know, and Birkenau and all of this huge, very big, huge drama. The thing that's most incredible to me is that Edith says to me, it was empty. They dropped us in a field, and it was completely empty. And Auschwitz was, at that point, was only for Russian POWs. There was 20,000 Russian POWs, and Polish prisoners who were communists, underground workers, intelligentsia, artists, anybody that wasn't for the invasion, you know, the Germans. And so Himmler decided that they needed to have a women's camp. They were gonna start to impound Jewish women, obviously. And so this Auschwitz one, if you've ever been to the museum of Auschwitz, Auschwitz one was the first camp. Birkenau was not really built yet. They did have the Russian prisoners over in some stalls. It used to be the horse stable. So Auschwitz I was originally for the Polish army. So these are actual brick barracks. And the women, they built a wall in the back of the camp. And these 10 barracks in the very back were where the women came in and out, and they had their own entrance. So this is block 10. I don't know if this will work, but let's try it and see if it will play. And Richard, you can let me know if it's playing. This is block 10, where the girls were first held. And this is, you're not allowed to go into this. It's not part of the regular tour. Yeah. So is it working?
It's kind of working.
Okay.
It stopped now.
Okay, that's so strange. Okay. So it is not part of the regular tour. I am allowed to go in because of my research, and it is vacant. It's you know, it's pretty amazing place to go into. So one of the things that we've done in terms of our work is we hired a portrait artist to take photographs of the women that I've written about and create portraits of them and dress them in Russian men's uniforms. The reason we do that is because when the girls arrive, they are not given striped dresses like you see in later photographs, 1943, 1944. They were given the Russian POWs uniforms after the Russians had been shot and killed. And these uniforms are huge. The women don't fit in them at all, right? I think this isn't going to work. We'll try it. But this is the footage that we have from the film that we created. This is in front of block 10, trying to show what the girls looked like. These are the actual faces of the girls at that time in uniforms. And one of the women, Linda Reich, talks about how the pants went up to her chin and the blouse went down to the ground. They had no underwear. They took their bras, they took their underwear, nothing underneath. And Rena used to say that this was, so painful. And the women in the audience, you know, if you're putting on scratchy wool over your nipples, you are gonna be rubbed raw in no time. It was very painful. And on top of that, the clothes had lice and bed bugs because they had been shot, and they were filthy when they were shot because they were prisoners of war. So this is really dehumanizing, but it's also dewomanizing. They shave their heads, take up all their hair, which we had our portrait artists do, so we could see what they looked like without their hair. Because that moment, this woman here, her name is Bertha Berkowitz, her head was shaved 7 times in Auschwitz, and she felt like committing suicide after it. And it was not just the dewomanizing of this experience, but it's the fact that if you're Orthodox, it should be a beautiful ritual shaving your head before you get married. And instead, so it's really like rape for some of these girls who are so young. Bertha was 16 when she came into Auschwitz, and she was brutally gynecologically examined, which they also did to the first 100 girls, and then they stopped. So they were really brutalized, this first transport by the SS. And Edith spoke about the dewomanization of Auschwitz, that you felt like you were not a woman anymore. And of course, one of the first things that happens is you lose your period. They put bromide in the tea and in the soup, and that helps stop menses. And it smells horrible, evidently, and very, very hard to eat it. And it also not only stops your menses, it befuddles your brain. So that's one of the ways they kept control of prisoners. People are like, why didn't they revolt? Well, the food was laced with, you know, something that, you know, sort of like Valium. And so it was very, very hard to revolt by the time they got there, nor did they know before it's too late. So I'm going to
So Heather, I've got your slideshow on my computer. I can share it and you can just tell me to advance the slides, and that'll maybe the video will work out.
You want to do that?
Yeah, let's try that.
Okay, great. So yeah, you know where we are. Yeah, so this, and I think you're gonna have to advance through this one because the images will show up. There we go. So this is Adela Gross in the middle with her arm around the little old lady. And Henya Ehrenberger is on the other side, sort of sandwiching that other old lady. Neither of those two girls survive. On the far edge, we have Anu Moskovichkova. Up above, from where the children are, that's Olga Hartman. And then we have, we're just going into the drone shot. Can you go back, Richard? Yeah, sorry. There we go. With the children, again, that's Olga Hartmanova. She's called Nutsi. There are letters between one of her surviving cousins who worked for a Gestapo member about her and about her death. And to all the way over is Magda Hartman, her cousin. Neither of these girls survive. In between, in the white shirt, that's Magda Amster, whose father tried to rescue her. He actually chased the train across Slovakia and couldn't save her, and she does not survive. And Magda Hans is the portrait, and she died just before the death march. Okay, so in August 1942, they moved the girls from Auschwitz I and the barracks to Birkenau. So we can go to the next slide, 12. If you've never been to Birkenau, if you've never been to the museum, it is huge. It's mind-boggling enormous. And nothing really does justice to it except drone. And it does so the women's camp is over on the left, where those blocks are, those flat blocks. the men's camp was over to the right. That burned, the Russians actually burned it. So we can go ahead to number 13. And I think this is the dramatization. Backwards a little. This shouldn't have been
early.
That's okay. So this is
Pope Robert. We had to line up, five in rows, and march to the railroad station. And far away, we saw already a long truck of cattle cars. We didn't even think of it, that those are suited for us. We are human beings. The guards started screaming. In Slovakia, naturally, up 30 Jewish horse and so on.
They put us in trains. We didn't know where we are going. We didn't have any idea. We were about 50 or maybe 60. Not water, not anything, not a little window, and locked from outside.
Go ahead and
move
to the And since we had some technical issues, we'll go ahead and move forward. So that's an excerpt from the film. And in the next bit, this is the next frame. Is that one gonna work? It doesn't look like that one's working. So the girls end up. The very first job that they have is incredibly difficult. If this one isn't working, we can go ahead and move forward.
That looks like the videos aren't shared with me, so like none of them are going to play. Okay.
Well, that's too bad. So the first job that they gave these young women was to demolition houses. How many of you have 16-year-old daughters that could tear down a house? And one of the things that I found most incredible, you know, Edith was really, really honest about her experience. And she said, you know, we were teenagers. We had temper tantrums. We didn't want to work. We were lazy, you know, and to act like a regular teenager in this kind of environment means you will die. They will kill you. So demolitioning houses was very dangerous as well, not only because of the hard work, but the SS liked to, they had to push the walls down, these brick walls down with poles. They had huge poles, 20 girls on a pole, and they would push them down and other girls would have to collect the bricks. And while they were collecting bricks, the SS would say, pushed this way so that they could crush some of the other girls. And the girls would work very hard to not do this to their friends, right? To protect their friends. Richard, let's go ahead and go to slide. Let's go to 17. We'll skip those other two. And this is an interior, if it works. Let's see if it works. And this is the interior of the blocks in Birkenau where they lived. And that's not gonna work. Oh, there, okay, well, we'll start here, that's fine. So the blocks are very, very different in Birkenau. They are, they're shelved. I think you probably may have an idea. They packed the girls in like sardines. There were 8 to 10 on a shelf. There were 3 levels. One was on the ground, which was not a good place to be because there were rats, and then the middle, and then the highest. And you usually slept with your friends as much as possible, right? Everybody tried to stay close together. Bertha Berkowitz speaks about they actually scratched in the koya, they call it the koya, where they slept, her name and all of her friends. And we were just in Auschwitz in March, and we got to film that. The names are almost gone, but Bertha actually in 2001 went back and re-scratched her name, and so you can see her name. Um, And yeah, quite extraordinary. This photograph is quite amazing. This is a staged photo. The SS were taking photographs to prove to the Red Cross that Auschwitz was not a death camp. And so this is called Canada. It's the sorting detail. It's one of the best jobs you could get. You weren't selected to die if you worked in Canada unless you were ill. And this image with the yellow arrow, this is Linda Reichbrader. She ended up in San Francisco. She was a wonderful, wonderful woman. And her friend, Mira Gold, is leaning over. And I just learned that this person, the woman walking away, that is Helena Citron, who ends up, there's actually just been a documentary out called Love It Was Not, about Helena's affair with an SS man, Franz Wunsch. And Linda actually, and Helena testified in Austria when Wunsch was on trial with SS Graf for murdering young men in the Sonderkommando after the blowing up of the crematoriums. Linda testified against him because she witnessed him murdering some of the young men of the Sonderkommando. And Helena Citron defended him, saying that he had saved her sister's life and he had saved her life, and he was let off. So our next slide, we're gonna move on to the liberation of Europe now. And these, once again, are this incredible, you know, some of these images come from archives. Up the top here, you have lying there, that's Bergen-Belsen, that's Bertha Berkowitz, who was liberated on April 19th. And this is a posed photograph. You can tell because the woman's arm is up, so you can see how thin she is. Also, Bertha was healthy. So they're trying to show that there was a typhus epidemic, but Bertha was actually healthy. And you can see below, she is healthy. She's walking there with two soldiers, and she's just brought them back from where they dumped the bodies in Bergen-Belsen. In the middle photo here, this is we have three survivors who in here, who on the very, very far, in the very front row, this very small woman, her name is Marta Mengel, and she survives with her three cousins. Well, all of her cousins survive, actually. And this group, they were escorted home from Prague by Czech and Polish men who wanted to make sure they wouldn't be raped on the road, because after the war, there was a lot of violence against women. And they walked them back to Slovakia. It took about a week, maybe longer. The very top, this is an archival photo from the JDC, and the woman with the white collar who's knitting in the very center, that is Ida Eigerman, and her daughter found the photo. And it matches the passport photo, same outfit that her mother was wearing when she got her first ID photo after liberation. And below is Rena and Danka, who was the subjects of my very first book, Rena's Promise, and Danka, who her sister, who came on the second transport, and they survived. And I will end here with my little, you know, the Holocaust is a horrible history. If you wanna just go ahead and move the slide, Richard. I believe, so I sit on the board of Cities of Peace Auschwitz. That painting, this is a copy of the painting. It's a huge work of art in Krakow, and it is the night sky on the, it is the constellations in the night sky and the liberation of Auschwitz. And the artist, Ellen Frank, who has just passed away, unfortunately, worked what she called Tonglen in Tibetan Buddhism, and it is the practice of breathing in negativity and exhaling positive, beautiful energy to transform the world, very like Tikkun Olam. And I think that for me, that's why this history is important. We acknowledge the history And by remembering these young women's place in history, we give them a voice, and hopefully we help support women and girls' rights in our future so that violence against young women ends. So with that, I will end. And if there's any questions, I'm here to try and answer them.
Thank you so much, Heather. And thank you for your patience with the technology and just rolling with all of this so gracefully. We really appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing the film. One of the first questions that came in was, when will this remarkable film be available?
That's from Rosette. This wonderful mother is in the film. We are hoping to lock our edit by August 15th. We're very, very close. I'm just flipping things around. And we have, I can't announce it yet, but we have been, we have made it to one festival so far, and hopefully we'll get into some more. Don't worry, Rosette, you'll be first on the list to know.
That's so great. There's a question here from Marcy, and let me read it to you. It says, your book is a compelling combination of history and personal stories. Thank you. Can you please speak to the choice of 999 young women and that very specific number? Your description of Himmler and Hitler's obsession with numerology, pagan mythology, and nine as a shadow number, and the combination of the three nines together is fascinating and disturbing.
It's so disturbing. So it's really creepy. I have to say, trying to unpack it verbally is really hard. I wrote a chapter about it. The astrology is so thick that unless I'm looking at it, I worked with an archival astrologer. It is really, really complicated, but Himmler had his own private astrologer, and every single date around the first transport connects to his astrological chart. The day that he went to Ravensbrück and ordered 999 kapos 2 weeks before the first transport is a date that is important to his zodiac chart. The 20th, when the girls start to get collected, is important. The day that they leave the train station, the time they arrive is like there's a lunar eclipse that's trined with Himmler's astrological chart. It's absolutely mind-blowing. And then on top of it, his name is 999. If you do the numerology on Heinrich Leopold Himmler, it's 999. So I read a book, where is it? I've got it around here somewhere. It's called Hitler's Monsters. And as I was reading it about Himmler and his astrology, I was just like, I just didn't think it was an accident, because it was not 1,000. Why? And he actually went to Ravensbrück 2 weeks before he ordered the first transport and ordered 999 kapos. That's a very specific number. So, with the help of professional astrologers and professional numerologists, we spent, a couple months looking through all of this stuff. And by the end of it, I was like, I was absolutely convinced. Himmler was a control freak. And they said at the end of the war, if you wanted to know what Himmler was going to do, the Nazis said, if you wanted to know what Himmler was going to do, you checked with his astrologer. So he didn't make a choice without going to his astrologer. And I truly, truly believe that the Wannsee Conference, which we only have a portion of the transcript from the Wannsee Conference, that the portion that's missing is about attacking young women and starting off with them. And they at least had enough sense to know it was in bad taste to have that public.
Mm-hmm. Heather, there's another question here. And this person asks, in the book, The Dressmakers of Auschwitz, the author states that the women primarily came from the Slovak region. Is this the same group that you are referring to?
It is, yeah. I haven't actually read that book, but one of the first women on, actually Elizabeth Silberman Bentz, ended up becoming a couture in Paris and having her own clothing line in Australia. And she wasn't one of those dressmakers, but she did make clothing for the SS. And that's one of the ways that she survived. So it is a lot of those Slovak girls, because they came early, they were able to, many of them were able to position themselves. And it's in this weird sort of way that, if you had a four-digit number and you made it through Auschwitz for those first 5 or 6 months, the SS had a little more respect for you if you were the early numbers. And in 1943, Bertha Berkowitz said, and I think Edith also said it, that Wardress Drexler just said, if you had the number one, you wouldn't be selected to go to the gas. And Rena said that the SS used to look and point at her number and go, oh, look, she was on the first transport.
Wow. Heather, it took you many years to write this book and a tremendous amount of research. I'm wondering two things. Can you tell us a little bit more about the research process and what was involved? And also, among all of this, were there some moments that really stand out to you, though, or that were really surprising with the things you were finding?
I love showing my favorite book. It's very well used. It's my doorstop. It's so well used, it's falling apart now. And I won't get another one because I have so many notes in this. So this is part of my research, It is the day-to-day workings of Auschwitz-Birkenau. And that is part of my research. A great deal of my research, I went into the Slovak National Archives. When I started this project, I thought I would do a film. I thought it would be easier than writing a book. It's not, because you have to raise money to do a film. So I walked around with a camera and I did a lot of filming. And then at some point, my husband actually said, if you don't write a book, somebody else is going to do that. So I took 2 years off and I wrote the book. And then I got my camera back out. But every time I interviewed Edith and actually Rosette's mother, anytime I did an interview, I filmed it. And not incredibly well, because I'm not a cinematographer. So a lot of bouncing around, but I got the women I was interviewing on tape. Certainly got Edith, and those testimonies were just extraordinary. So, like I was saying, when I had Edith, I could call her up and I would say, I remember Regina Klein, who was a German survivor who I wanted to interview, and then she decided she didn't want to do an interview and she wasn't feeling well. And I saw in a photograph that Edith had a picture with Regina Klein when they were children. And I said, you knew Regina, because in the transport list, it says that Regina was from another region. She goes, oh, I grew up with Regina and we lived in Prague together after the war. Her husband was a writer too. And Edith was married to a very famous author. And I'm like, wait. And it is, Irina Fine says that in her testimony, she tells, there was this girl from Humana and she had a limp and she wasn't going to go on the death march. And I said, you have to go. And I went, oh my God, that's Edith. Mm-hmm. And then at the end of her testimony, she says she was picked up from the Toronto airport by a friend. I went, Edith, did you pick Irina up at the airport? She goes, oh yeah, she's an old, I grew up with her. Mm-hmm. But you don't know that from the Shoah Foundation tapes, right? And so Edith was this incredible conduit that told me so much more about this transport. Wow. All of these young women who were connected, because you can look at the list and you can see the names, but you don't know for sure they're cousins or sisters or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, that was really, that for me, those connections were just phenomenal.
Yeah, it makes it feel like a very small world when you see how everyone...
Slovakia is a very small world.
Yeah.
It is.
In your book, Heather, I love that you don't end the book with liberation, but you really continue instead to tell the stories of the survivors and how they were received in their new places and the challenges they faced. And I feel like this is such an important part of the history that often gets left off of books and films. And can you tell us, you touched on this a little bit in the presentation, but can you tell us a little bit more what life was like for the survivors after they were liberated?
Yeah, you know, it was hell. I mean, Edith said to me, and I've heard many survivors say it, you know, we thought that because we survived the Holocaust, the world would change and it would become a better place and there would be peace and there would be the second coming and, you know, and that, and the Messiah would arrive. Everybody was like, in that sort of frame of mind. And instead, humanity continued to kill each other and wreak havoc. I can't tell you how many survivors I heard say, you know, they heard Slovaks say, about the Jews, more have come back than left. Mm. Anti-Semitism was still rampant. One of the girls, Rena Fine and Edith's friend, Gizzy Gromarova, was murdered a few months after liberation, and she was murdered by Ukrainian fascists who walked into a Jewish cafe and killed everybody. One of the things that I love that Edith said is, we look normal, but we're not.
Mm.
And the other thing that is really important is that, you know, nobody knew what post-traumatic stress was at that point. They didn't go get therapy, right? They got work. Edith wanted to go back to school. Bertha Berkowitz wanted to go back to school. They didn't finish high school, right? Some girls just wanted to get married and start families because they had no family, right? And I think it's just really important that we understand. It is sort of my pet peeve about fictionalizing the Holocaust. They love to rosy glow it and they love to make it like, oh, you know, you're a hero and you're wonderful and you're a human being. You know, mm-hmm. you didn't do everything right. No human being does. And if you survived the Holocaust, you certainly didn't, because it screwed up your life. And mm-hmm. And I think it's somebody said to me, I'm so tired of Holocaust novels where they're love stories. Oh, we met in Auschwitz it's okay, you know, like that's true for some people, but it wasn't true for everybody. And I think that life goes on, you know, and we can see it with Ukraine today. I mean, if the war ended in Ukraine tomorrow, there would be a lot of damage, psychological damage for people mm-hmm. to survive. And that's a short, hopefully, if it should stop tomorrow.
Yeah, I think, as you pointed out, that in so many books and films, and even in the world today, we look at survivors of any tragedy and we're just like, well, thank God they survived. And, you know, it's either dismissed or we assume like they just went on and life was fine. But the struggles that they face are so deep and so real. It's a hard life ahead. There was one author who wrote that the hardest part of surviving was survival itself. And that just really, I think, speaks volumes to what lays ahead in the years coming. Will you tell us, Heather, about the book that you're working on now?
Sure. It's a wonderful story. And it is about a young woman who is an artist. She's in Paris. She's super smart. And she falls in love with a Gentile and is denounced and made a political prisoner and sent to Auschwitz. and she is the posthumous aunt of one of my best friends. Mm-hmm. And they've been wanting me to do her story for years, and I, you know, pushed it away and pushed it away. And then her mother, who's in her 90s, just inherited, or didn't just, but inherited a box of letters and of Annette's art, which her brother had not shared with the family ever. And so we had this rich, rich resource of letters, and the letters go back and forth between the Depot and Tourelle, which are prisons in Paris. And the funny thing that I had with that book is that, you know, I can write about Auschwitz, but the Depot and Les Tourelles, I had no idea. Mm-hmm. And so it really got under my skin. It was really hard to write about. And that was sort of interesting. So that comes out in January, I'm not making a movie of it. So, but I'm sort of continuing in that vein. Annette Zellman, Annette was on the third convoy from France, and it was the first convoy of French women into Auschwitz. And one of the most chilling moments for those girls is that they arrive in Auschwitz. The first thing, and this always, so when I'm doing research, one of the things I really look for is a witness to tell me about my subjects, because the subjects can't see themselves, right? So a witness who sees somebody gives you a perspective that is really valuable. So for one instance, there's a capo who writes about the young women coming into camp and how they were well-dressed and carrying their bags. And you know, and she's been in Ravensbrück for 2 years, 3 years. She knows what's gonna happen. And she sees these innocent young women coming in. Well, when these French women arrive, one of the survivors of the transport, who's quite well-renowned, her name is Rhea Kagan, and she has an amazing memoir that has not been translated into English, unfortunately. It's in Hebrew and French. But writes about, they see these little, like scrawny little boys, and they come running over to them, and then they realize they're girls, and those are the Slovak mm-hmm. girls, because they have no hair, they're really dirty, they're wearing Russian uniforms, and they're super thin, and they don't understand what they're saying, because they're all speaking Slovak. To find that reference to my girls is like, oh God, you know, like there they are, like that's what they looked like. And I don't, you know, they don't tell me that, right? They don't tell me what they look like because they didn't know. So that was really, really incredible. And then the other thing that happens is that when they're sent into processing, and of course the first thing that happens when you arrive in Auschwitz is they take off all your clothes and you stand naked in front of men, which is really traumatizing, especially if you're a young Orthodox Jewish girl or just, you know, a private person. Rudolf Hess, the head of the commandant of Auschwitz, comes in with some of his favorite SS. They walk in to the processing center where all the French girls are standing naked, and they go, they ogle them and say, Paris has arrived in Auschwitz. Hmm. And they mock them because they have nail polish on their nails.
Hmm. Wow.
And then they shave them.
Well, I'm really looking forward to seeing this book. Heather, your research and the stories that you have brought to light are just truly outstanding. I feel like they shine a light on these stories that we haven't necessarily heard before, and that's so important to bring them forward. Thank you so much for doing that and for telling us about these amazing women today.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, it's really been a pleasure having you with us. And
anybody who, I see there's other questions here, if you do have a question, and you can always post it on my on the Facebook page. That's one way to have a public conversation. That's why I love seeing that. And you can also email me. You can find me through 999themovie.com.
Great. Oh, that's great. Thank you. Thank you for your willingness to continue to field questions. I know there were quite a few. Yes. Wonderful.
Thank you, everybody, so much. Have a beautiful summer.
And thank you to everyone for joining today's program. This program was recorded and you will find it on our website starting tomorrow. One person asked if they could share it with others, and absolutely, and thank you for asking, and we are grateful for all the support that you provide. Please join us on August 2nd for our next Lunch and Learn program entitled So They Remember Surviving the Holocaust in Soviet Ukraine with Maxine Goldenstein. Our Lunch and Learn programs are possible because of all of you and because we have a fantastic team at the Holocaust Center. I want to take a moment to thank Richard Green, our museum and technology director, who you heard as a voice in the background and who's running the technical side of this program. Thank you to our CEO, Dee Simon, Lori Werschel-Cohen, Paul Regelbrug, Jessica Michaels, Julia Thompson, Morgan Romero, Amanda Davis, Devonshire Lockie, and Katie Lawrence. Thank you again for joining today's program. We look forward to seeing you, hopefully, this Thursday at the Sip and Learn program or on August 2nd for our next Lunch and Learn program. This concludes our program for today.